language of the people here. Are there any other Lenape folks in the audience? If you are, please come join me. My people are the Wolf Clan of the Lenape, the Mohegan, and we live now in Connecticut, but we spend a great deal of time here in Manahatta. So with Wom in Manahatta, that's how we say welcome to Manhattan. I'm going to read you a prayer in our language and then in English, and I'm going to struggle through it. Because here, our languages were not allowed to be spoken in the schools, especially in Connecticut until recently, and we're recovering them. So please bear with me as I struggle with the ancient words of this place. Nakasanaki, Kataptamoya Manwuchi, Maskanetahak Squak, Yotai Yokisk, Kataptamoya Manwuchi, Wamina, Kiskitayawanwak, Mowayawak, Wuchana Wawahatatak, Ni Apuyawatak, Ta Kunapti, Nik Sakatahak, Womamayak, Wojashanamash Tatahakawanawanash, Ta Kutapashki, Quat, Hamawank Wuchi, Makataks, Kayayankawash, Umuntu. Uchi Gewaya, Kuti Hatatamaman, Uipi Pish, Kutayamamaman, Osawanamak, Mother Earth. Thank you for all brave women here today. They honor us with their stories. We thank you for all who made this gathering possible. We ask that you protect them in this space and everywhere along their healing trail. We ask that you open our ears and minds to the gravity of their precious words, so that we may not merely listen, but act for change. Niayo Tabani.
Cousin, he didn't eat his spring-caught blackfish. He wanted to study them, to open them, to took one blackfish and held it in his hand. But he didn't wake it. He took a knife and he cut it from anus to head up the belly. But he didn't see lungs or guts or blood. He held the knife in his right hand, the blackfish in his left. But after the cut, he couldn't hold onto the fish. It dissolved in his hand. It became a kind of thick, black liquid goo. He tried to stop it from slipping through his fingers, but the blackfish goo got heavier as it dripped toward the floor, and the whole mess of it slipped off of his palm, gathering in a puddle at his feet. So he tried another, same thing. If you cannot cut a blackfish open to look at its insides, can you study its insides, he asked me. But he didn't give me time to answer. Instead, he continued, I couldn't cut another. I ate my last two blackfish, and I ate the blackfish that were sitting upright in my father's bucket, the ones he caught for feasting in late winter, Emily. I ate five blackfish, he said. Good God, I said. Nobody eats five blackfish. You eat one for health, but my cousin, he thought that if he ate a lot of blackfish, he could find out about the blackfish soul, about what they dreamed during the ice over, about their survival through the harshest conditions, laying in buckets in homes away from the cold, deep habitat of river and mud, about their swim down our throats. He thought there was something the blackfish could teach him, that he could maybe in turn teach his family and friends and teacher at school. But the blackfish just made him puke. It came pouring out of his mouth, sliding over his tongue, that same thick black liquid goo he felt slipping through his fingers toward the floor. It pulled out of him, leaving him feeling cleaner than before, but with a horrible taste in his mouth. He lay down, belly pressed to the floor. He couldn't move, so he fell asleep. He told me, the blackfish are unstudyable. They exist to live in rivers and buckets and bellies. You cannot cut a blackfish open, please. Do not try. You cannot eat too many. Trust me, don't. But when the blackfish enters your dreams, you hold still and listen to what it says. It will tell you when to swim headfirst into nature. It will tell you when to press your belly down wherever you are and rest. It will tell you how to survive this world. It will tell you its secrets.
A miracle.
What about Alaska?
Next time. I promise. and he was very abusive, ungodly. The earliest that I remember, I was 4 years old. We were in his trailer house, and my mom was screaming. I'm under the table. I'm screaming. The lights are off. The light from the outside is coming through the post from the window. And the door is here. The couch is here. The TV is here. And the gun rack is right here. And the table in the kitchen is right here. And I'm under the table. My mom is screaming, "Not even now!" And I see him grab the gun. And he starts beating my mother over the head with the butt of the shotgun until the only screams that could be heard were mine, coming from under the table. And I think he beat her to what he believed was to death. He put the gun on the gun rack. He called her a bitch. He walked into the bedroom, slammed the door, and he sat down on the squeaky bed. And then I heard the thud-thud of his cowboy boots as he lay down, squeaking again, and he went to sleep. So I crawl over to my mom, and I'm crying so hard because I think she's dead. And my mom's in a, she's in a white t-shirt, denim jeans, white canvas shoes, and a denim jacket. And of course, the blood is splattered all over her white shirt. And so I wipe her blood-strewn hair from her face. And I put my face down to her mouth to see if I can feel it breathing. See her, see if she's breathing. And I can't feel it. So then I start crying again. And I'm only four. And I make myself stop crying again. And I put my head down to her chest to see if I could still feel it rising. And it was. So I grabbed the blanket off the couch and I covered her up. And I sat by her all night. And if I fell asleep, I would get mad at myself because, you know, hurry up and check to see if she's still alive, see if she's still breathing. And it's not that I could have saved her. It's just that I didn't want her to die alone.
This is Lisa Brunner. She's not an actor. This is her story. She's one of our strong hearts.
There would be times we would be, I would take and he'd be chasing us. I would get her out. And I'm still just a little baby. Just a baby. And there is this field. And I'd say, "Mom, get down. The moon is full." And I'd make her get down. And then we would crawl across this big field until we got to the woods. And then I took her to my hiding place. And then we'd listen to him, to his screams about how he was going to kill us when he found us. And she'd lay down and she'd go to sleep. And if I heard it coming, I would wake her up and I would take her deeper into the woods. Because he had been in Vietnam. So when I reflect back, he was afraid of the woods. He was afraid of the night. In the woods, the night, we were safe. The moon was our sanctuary, if we could make it.
Hello.
I'm Terry Hinner.
Do you need something?
Yeah, I'm Terry Hinner.
Okay.
Is this the office on Mom's gift list?
You're looking at it.
There's no carpet.
Is that a problem?
No, I just thought
it. Oh, you thought because today's your first day, we roll out red carpet for you?
I thought there would be carpet, yeah.
You work for the federal government now. You'll learn to do without. Here's everything you'll need. To start with, I want
get it.
Well, you'd be surprised how many folks don't. Okay, so this is the funding office. We provide all the funds to the tribes for their DV programs. Of course, we don't, at least not yet, have an efficient mechanism that the tribes can use to apply for funds. Oh, and our reports to Congress, you'll be responsible for writing those. Basically, you'll be doing all of the policy work for the implementation of the VAWA grants in Indian country. Any questions?
Yeah, please.
Good, and welcome. We do so much work with the tribes, it's nice to finally have an Indian in the office.
One sunny afternoon in May, I was returning my daughters to their father. I dropped them off and I made sure he was home and they were in the house before leaving. But he walked out to stand beside my car. I stayed in the car with the door locked, but the windows were down. He seemed agreeable enough at first, but then he became angry because I didn't wish him a happy anniversary. I told him that I really didn't think it was appropriate under the circumstances. He suddenly lunged in the car window and he snatched my purse, taking out a small address book. He flipped through it and became angry, and then he suddenly lunged in again and snatched my car keys from the ignition and walked away. And he was going to throw the keys. We live in the mountains of western North Carolina. There are trees and woods, things like that all around, pretty much everywhere. And that was the only car key I had, and I thought, if he throws that key, if I don't have a way to get out of here, I don't know what I'm going to do. And so I was trying to get the key. He turned and he finally said, okay, you can have your keys. He threw them on the ground. And when I leaned down to get the keys, he kicked me and I rolled down a little hill. At the time, my youngest daughter was standing beside my car at the bottom of the hill. I didn't even know she was outside. I thought she was in the house. And when I rolled down the hill, I rolled into her and she fell. And he grabbed her. I was trying to comfort her, but he grabbed her. He was pulling. She must have been around 4 or 5 years old at the time. He was pulling so hard that I was sliding across the ground, so I let go. He went immediately to the police department before I could get up to go there.
Can I help you? I need a protective order for my wife. She's a danger to her children.
What made you say that?
She hit our daughter. Knocked her down, left her on the ground.
I'm sorry, but we don't have jurisdiction over non-Indians on the reservation.
She's enrolled.
Oh. Well, I guess just fill this out and we'll process it.
Thanks.
He was able to get a protective order against me, for him, and for my daughters. And he knew that I was not a danger to my children. He knew that when I had my oldest daughter, I was so afraid of doing things wrong that I read every book I could get my hands on about raising children, different child psychology books, things like that, just because I wanted to make sure I did it right. And I was there at the police department.
raped. They go missing, they're murdered.
And our office gives the tribes the money they need to deal
yes,
with that.
Yes, but after the fact.
The fact of what?
We come in after the violence has occurred. By the time women walk in the door of one of our programs, they're already a victim.
Right, you're not a victim unless something has happened.
We're
to
just
you.
Doing triage. We need to do something more.
Look, I know you're new around here, so let me explain something to you. It's a miracle you can give tribes any funding at all. A lot of women worked really hard in 94 to get the Violence Against Women Act passed. You should be thankful for what you have.
My name is Lenora. That's my English name. I'm Yupik from the native village of Amana. My people have been here for thousands of years. From the time of the glaciers until now. When I look around me, I know that my ancestors sat on the same rocks, hunted the same sea, camped along the same rivers. They made their campfires where our fires still burn today. But in the last 60 years, since 1959, our whole world has changed. Growing up, I didn't have contact with the outside world. When I was born, the state didn't exist. This wasn't Alaska. This was our home. The home of my grandparents and their grandparents before them. Imana, where my family and I live today, this is where we came to fish. We didn't live here year round. We camped here during the summer and whatever we caught, we ate the whole winter. The fish are how my ancestors survived. And they're how I survive. Blackfish. That's what Imanok means in Yupik. In Yupik, we say Imanok. The whites heard that and said Imanok. But our home, Imanok, here, this is where we came to fish for the blackfish. But in 1959, they told us, this is a state. This is Alaska. Then the BIA showed up, they built a school, and told us our children had to go, or our parents would be thrown in jail. So my parents, my family, we had to move. They moved to Amanok so I could go to school. When we got to school, they told us we had to speak English. Anyone caught speaking Yupik would be punished. And they told me natives like my parents were dirty, stupid, ignorant. But I knew that wasn't true. This new state, when they came in, they took away our fish, our food, and our children. They took away our language and our sense of identity. And in exchange, we got alcohol. And with their alcohol came their violence. We have never experienced anything like this before. Our women, we weren't really sure what to do. For the first time in our lives, we faced epidemic levels of domestic violence, sexual violence in our villages and in our homes. Here in Amanok, it's very isolated. There's no roads to connect us to other villages. Our women, when they're abused, they have nowhere to go. So in 1979, I worked to open the first and only Native women's domestic violence shelter in the state of Alaska. Of the 229 tribal villages in Alaska, we're the only village that has a shelter. It's very important that we keep our shelter open 24 hours, especially in the winter. Sometimes the wind chill can get down to minus 70 degrees. It's very expensive to keep the electricity going, but in 2005, the state of Alaska withdrew all of our funding. We were forced to close our doors, and I thought we would remain closed forever. What's this?
Enough to keep you open?
To
military.
Take it. It's not for me.
To the DOJ grant office.
When we had to close our doors, I put three mothers on the street.
Sorry, Paul.
We have to do more than give them shelter.
Lynn?
Suzanne, you made it. You're here now, and you're safe. The far room on the right. Matrona put sheets on your bed, and after you get settled in, she'll make you sleep.
Susanna's from Papa.
So she had to get on a plane just to get here.
We're the only native shelter in the state.
There's nowhere else I can go.
She got a protection order in Papa against her husband. He tried to kill her. And now the state of Alaska refuses to honor it, and that's why she's here.
It's a protection order. They have to honor it.
Won't. Not when the order comes from our tribes or from one of our villages.
How can they refuse to enforce a protection order?
They say we don't have jurisdiction.
What are you doing?
What's it look like I'm doing? I'm packing.
Did you ask me to take time off? Our report to Congress is due at the end of the month, and I'm going to need you to...
Yeah, I'm not coming back.
What?
I'm going home to Cherokee.
Oh, I suppose the rats were just too much for you?
No, I'm just done applying Band-Aids.
Our Band-Aids make a difference. They provide your people with funding.
We don't need your funding.
The tribes do. They want to provide shelter, food, counseling.
Yeah, but we have to do more than just give women counseling.
Oh, you're right. Please, stand back and let me wave my magic wand and make all the violence go away.
We don't need your magic wand. We need jurisdiction.
Second, a third, a fourth, a fifth.
If you're so upset, why don't you make one of your calls? You don't want to call anymore.
It's okay, baby.
Yeah, I'll make a call for you.
Trouble police, is this an emergency?
Oh, well, not exactly.
Found you?
Hey, I just want to apologize because, you see, I got a little carried away this morning. Well, I hit my wife.
Who am I speaking with?
Well, I hit her pretty hard, you know? She started crying.
You enrolled?
Well, I'm a white guy. Is that a problem?
You called before.
Yeah.
Nothing's changed. If you're not enrolled, we don't have jurisdiction.
He says he doesn't have jurisdiction. Thanks for the help, officer. When will you finally get it?
He can do whatever he wants.
They can't touch me.
Thank you for...
CEO.
Sorry?
This is Eastern Man. We don't say OCO. You're not in Oklahoma anymore.
I have a question.
Yes.
How long will this take?
Oh, with what I'm prepared to present, about 40 minutes.
No. I mean the campaign. How long will it take to get this bill passed? You know, with the tribal jurisdiction provision.
Well, with this Congress, who knows? It could take quite a while.
Quite a while?
Months? Years?
Well, nothing's guaranteed.
We've been working on this for years.
I'm well aware.
We sponsored the Y number 2 ceremony when Senator Biden was preparing the draft of VAWA 2005.
I remember that.
And you think the time is now?
Yes.
What makes this different than 2005?
We don't want to put money into this if Congress isn't going to act in 5 years.
We need them to act now.
You need them to act now.
This has nothing to do with me.
Terry here is co-chair of the NCAI Task Force on Violence Against Women.
Prior appointment.
And it has no effect on my service to counsel.
This whole VAWA thing, I know she's very passionate about it.
What's your point?
It's her pet project.
We need jurisdiction.
And we tried in 2005.
What's your
and
point?
And they did in 2005 of the Travel Law and Order Act.
Right, but what's your point?
Why should Eastern Band be the one to put the bill for everyone?
If I may interject,
please.
I know it's a lot to ask, but you we won't be the only ones.
Now, I know Samuel stepped up, and Chief Anderson has promised to support the Choctaw.
What about the Muscogee Creek?
When it comes to this, we have to stop thinking about this is my tribe and their tribe. Divide and conquer has been the other side's philosophy since 1492.
What are our chances?
To get a bill passed? It's going to be very difficult.
But not impossible.
We couldn't get the Dems on Indian Affairs to put it in tribal law in order just last year.
That was a campaign.
If we can't win the Dems, we'll never reach the Republicans.
This is different.
I'm just being honest with you, Terry.
Councilwoman Henry, to you, Mr. Whitehawk, and let me tell you something about our tribal council. Our tribal council doesn't do things because they're possible. We do things because as tribal council, it's our responsibility to protect everybody in our community. Every citizen, every man, woman, and child. If we can't protect our own women, how can we protect our community? I mean, think about it this way. If we can protect a woman who's being battered or abused in her own home, or sexually violated in her home, or the children, and that protects the next house, and the house after that, and the house after that, it's the entire community we're trying to protect. This isn't about what we can do. Not what we should do. And what we should do is fight for this Congress to recognize the inherent sovereignty we have as a tribal government to protect our own people.
I think we should put it to a vote.
Okay. All in favor?
Aye.
All opposed? Mr. Whitehawk, you're authorized to lobby on behalf of the Eastern Band Cherokees for the reauthorization of the Violence Against Women Act, specifically to advocate for the passage of the proposed tribal jurisdiction provision. Meeting's adjourned. City of Cotter. Thank you.
Skeet.
Now, we expect a full court press.
You'll get nothing less.
Very difficult.
This will be difficult.
Yeah, you know what's difficult? Listen to women who've been raped, abused, battered, asking for help, and have to tell them there's nothing you can do if you don't have jurisdiction.
I know.
Yeah, I'm sure you think you do.
I'm just tribal police before I went to law school.
Oh.
I get a call, but before I can help her, I have to ask, where is she? Is she on Lennon's tribal trust?
Lennon's been so.
She could be on fee land.
You can't just ask, where is she? You gotta ask, who is he?
Is he Indian?
Is he enrolled?
If he's not,
we don't have jurisdiction.
He's the number one answering phone.
Yeah.
I'll get us 2 tickets to D.C. for Monday.
Two?
You're coming with me.
No, I'm not.
I need you to walk the hallways up there with me.
I think you're confused. I hired you, not the other way around.
I'll do the work, but I need you to be the voice.
Why me?
I'm Dennis. No one cares what I think or say, but you're a native woman in a leadership position. You're Councilwoman Henry.
Call me Terry.
I'll have my staffer get started on this right away.
We need to do this now.
Before this year's election.
Well, of course.
Republicans definitely need women in 2012.
And we can't capitalize on that.
Is there someone you can reach to across the aisle?
Crapo agreed to co-sponsor.
Who's that?
Mike Crapo, Republican from Idaho.
You're going to take this to a Republican?
Mike's good on Indian.
Someone's going to listen to a Democrat from Vermont.
We need him.
Okay.
I'll have my staff send you a draft of what we put together.
And you're serious about this?
We are 100% behind you.
Yeah, but are you really behind us?
I'm not sure what you mean.
When you can't get the 60 votes you need, who's going to be on the chopping block?
Well, that's not how this works.
Hey, don't get cheeky with me.
Terry.
Is anything like the last 400 years? You know who's going to be the first to fall off? Not immigrants. Not LGBTQ. It's going to be our Indian women.
That won't happen.
This bill is not going to protect anyone until it protects everyone.
I promise. We won't remove the tribal jurisdiction provision.
Well, we got the chair of the Judiciary Committee. That's a good start.
What's next?
We're scheduled to visit Murkowski.
What's wrong?
He's got an email for a staffer.
Senator! Thank you so much for moving around your schedule so you can speak with me.
What do we need to discuss?
The VAWA.
I've made my decision clear.
We know you intend to vote for it.
That's not a woman in the Senate, is it?
The draft is still in committee.
It's scheduled for a vote next week.
The tribal jurisdiction provision.
What about it?
The folks back in Juneau.
You mean your boss?
The AG thinks it could use some editing.
The committee's already agreed on the language.
What about an exception?
Or a lack.
What a great idea, Senator. Wish I thought of that myself.
I can't just tell the committee I changed my mind.
Well, tell them Alaska's different. You and I both know there are no tribes left in Alaska.
So Senator Cornyn...
Yeah, I know. He's completely opposed. I read his website.
We'll never get his vote.
So why are we here?
Because we need his silence. He has influence.
A senator can't meet with you, so it'll be me today. And you are...
Terry Henry. I'm the tribal counsel for Eastern Mediterranean.
And she's the co-chair for the National Congress of American Indians Committee on Violence Against Women.
Okay.
We're here to talk about Lady Crapo. If you've had a chance to read the
bill. I'm just going to stop you right there and be honest with you. We brought our pajamas.
Your pajamas?
Yeah, we're willing to stay as late as we need to tonight to work this out.
I guess I forgot mine.
What's on the table?
Well, we'd like to propose some language.
You took out the jurisdiction provision.
We replaced it with federal delegation.
That won't work.
We need jurisdiction.
Congress can't recognize jurisdiction in Indian tribes.
Why not?
It's unconstitutional.
No, it's pre-constitutional. We existed as sovereign nations before you even had this document you call the doctor constitution.
Terry.
The Supreme Court was very clear in Oliphant's. Tribes don't have jurisdiction. I mean, over non-natives. You, of course, have jurisdiction over your own people.
Just not your people.
If this is your attempt to charm the senator into voting for the bill, you're failing.
We got the votes we need.
In the Senate, but not in the House.
Oh, I'm sorry. Does Senator Cornyn get a vote in the House, too?
Look, we're here to negotiate a deal with you. And you want to negotiate with us, so you do not have to negotiate with Cantor.
Maybe I want to negotiate with Cantor.
Cantor won't let this go through the House. No way, not in a million years. Now Senator Cornyn could talk to him. He has some influence, you know? Of course, you have to agree to replacing jurisdiction with delegation.
Never.
Fine.
Thank you for your time.
You might pass the Senate, but you'll never pass the House.
We gotta work on tone. My tone's fine.
We're asking the people to give us something we want.
No. No, no, no. We are asking them to give us back something they should have never taken.
I agree with that, but it's 2012, not 1877. We have to take what we can get. Where are you going?
To talk to senators. Go get votes.
Terry?
Don't worry, I'll use my southern charm.
That's awful.
I know, it's the truth.
I had no idea.
Senator Romney, a minute.
This is coming from Crapo?
I'm in a rush.
Yes.
Right.
I'd like to talk to you about VAWA.
Senator Heller wants you to know.
The tribal jurisdiction.
You have his vote.
Thank you.
You have my vote.
For Lady Crapo?
Yes.
Thank you. Senator Collins.
Who are you?
I'm Dennis Whitehawk. I represent the Eastern Band of Cherokee.
And you want to talk to me about VAWA?
Yes.
Well, I spoke to Patty.
We have questions.
I like your answers.
The tribal jurisdiction provision is very important.
You have my vote.
Thank you.
Senator McCain agrees.
Well, we need to be able to protect our native women.
You have his vote.
Thank you.
But he told me to tell you he just doesn't think it's going to pass the House.
Senator Stone.
We'd like to talk to you about VAWA. Sure.
But jurisdiction is critical without it.
You have my vote.
Thank you.
And the vote of every Republican woman in the Senate.
That's great.
You look surprised.
Well, I just guess I didn't.
You didn't think a bunch of Republicans would support you on this. Let me tell you something. We may be Republicans, but first and foremost, we're women.
That's
a lot of Republicans.
I talked to Brown.
I spoke to Snow.
McCain Stafford.
And Heller.
They said yes.
He might have enough votes.
Senator Moran wanted me to tell you.
No, Senator Rubio, with all due respect,
you
won't change my mind.
Let me say why.
You can't negotiate with Cornyn, you can't negotiate with him.
Let me get this straight.
Big government and inefficiency.
The tribal jurisdiction provision restores jurisdiction at the local level.
No, you're taking authority away from the state and giving it to the Fed.
That's not at all what we're doing.
I read the bill.
Oh, Senator Shelby wanted me to tell you.
McCain's voting for it.
I am Senator Lee, not Senator McCain.
His vote is no.
Wait, does he understand?
I'm waiting for a meeting.
Senator Toon.
Yes?
I'd like to talk to him about
I have a meeting with Senator Wicker.
Well, he's not here.
The tribal jurisdiction provision is very important.
I understand your position.
When will he be back?
I've made up my mind.
Are you saying we can discuss VAWA?
I've already discussed it with
my
him.
My vote is no.
He's against it.
No.
No?
I'm sorry, I can't help you.
You just don't agree here.
Thank you for your time.
Maybe he says the vote's next week.
I'm a Native American statistic. I'm a survivor of sexual and physical violence. My story starts in the 70s as a toddler. You may wonder how do I remember this when this occurred. I was the size of a couch cushion, a red velvet, approximately 2.5 feet couch cushion. One of the many girls violated and attacked by a man that had no boundaries or regards for a little child's life. My life. The man responsible was never convicted. In the early 80s, at a young age, I was asked to babysit my auntie's children. During the late hours of the evening, she arrived, but she wasn't alone. Instead of packing my things to go home, my sense was to quickly grab the children, the 4 or 5 men that followed my auntie home. raped her. I had to protect the children and hide. I could not save my own deed. I only heard her cries. Today's the first time that I've ever shared this story. She died at a young age. The perpetrators were never prosecuted. The majority of our girls have struggled with sexual and domestic violence. Not once, but repeatedly. My question for Congress has and has always been, why did you not protect me?
Why did you not protect me?
Or me?
Why didn't you protect my family?
Why is my life?
And my life.
And the life of so many other Native American women less important? I'm urging Congress to uphold the U.S. Constitution and honor our treaty agreements. Thank you.
Thank you.
For standing up.
For speaking out.
So are you.
What do you need, Deb?
Me?
You had anything to eat?
No, I'm fine.
You've been at it for days now. We haven't seen you eat a thing.
No, I'm hungry.
Well, I brought your sandwich.
What do you think of the sentence? The tribal jurisdiction provision of the reauthorization of VAWA 2013 recognizes the rights of our Native women to be free of violence and abuse, as well as the inherent sovereign authority of tribes to protect their own citizens.
Sounds good to me.
Too many comments.
I think it's fine.
People stop listening to you. It's too many comments.
I don't think people hear comments.
I hear comments all the time. You bother me. You're a lawyer. Don't you spend years studying workplace law?
I was tribal police before I went to law school. Right, well, that was my entire childhood. I never got to sleep in on a Saturday morning because he would always drag me out of bed and throw me in the car. He made me go with him, whether I wanted to or not, you know, tribal court. I remember he always had, like, back then, a legal case. It was like a book. And he had these printed out cases, we'd drive, several hours sometimes. He'd say, okay, read this to me. So I'd read the case to him and say, well, what do you think that means? And I'd try to tell him, well, maybe this guy did this, and that person did that. And he'd say, well, think about this. I was just a kid, so I understood very little of it. But he was teaching me at a very young age to respect the law.
I thought about going to law school.
Don't.
You did?
I had to.
Did your dad make you go?
No, my decision was that personal. Sorry, it's not something I talk about.
Y'all don't have the TV on?
No.
Well, what the heck are you doing in here?
We're talking.
You're crying out loud, turn on these fans.
Young man, I need to concentrate.
They voted!
What?
We won!
Oh my god.
We got 68.
68 votes?
For real?
We just had the Senate!
Woo! Oh, thank you.
Oh, don't thank me.
Thank the creator.
We're doing this, aren't we?
Oh, we're hugging. Okay.
What are you doing? We had the votes.
We didn't until the very last second.
How long did it take me to convince you this campaign would be worth it?
I didn't think you'd be convincing.
Really?
You had me at OCO.
Look, they took out Alaska.
What?
Alaska. It's been carved out.
Carved out?
Section 910, right here.
Special rule for the state of Alaska.
What?
No tribes in Alaska have jurisdiction.
Except Matt.
One try.
The other 228 are out.
But he told you they were in.
Murray said they would not be left out.
Someone lied to us.
Kowski?
Outlandish.
Unbelievable.
I gotta talk to Lynn.
Murkowski said it was a drafting error.
It's definitely a drafting error.
Why didn't you take it out?
I couldn't.
You're on the committee.
State lobbied hard on this.
What was their position?
910 is needed to protect the state's rights.
You mean Alaska's rights?
Look, I tried to get it out, but we didn't have agreement.
We?
I'm not the only senator from Alaska.
I am not talking to the press.
I just need one quote.
I said no.
Senator Murkowski refused to comment.
Off the record or on?
We're online in 20.
It was a drafting error.
A drafting error?
I didn't know it was in there.
Who put it in?
I'm not sure.
It states explicitly, sections 904 and 905 do not apply to tribes in Alaska, except a Metlakatla. You didn't know the bill contained a special carve-out for your state?
I told you, I didn't know.
Do you plan to fix it?
It's not that simple.
Alaska's not included.
Not included?
They carved you out.
Why?
Alaska's different.
Tom, it's good to see you. Congrats on passing the Senate.
Thank you.
I hear you're representing the Eastern Band.
Yeah.
You forget you're from Oklahoma?
Don't worry. Still got my twang.
Well, it's good to hear.
So, how do we get Leahy Crapo to the House to try to stop team?
I'm not sure we can.
That's not what I wanted to hear.
Well, Boehner signed Cantor to VAWA.
I know.
And he's opposed to tribal jurisdiction.
Based on what?
I think the Constitution.
Where in the Constitution does it say tribes no longer have jurisdiction?
You don't have to convince me.
I know. Sorry. Okay, so what's your plan?
I'm not sure at this point. Cantor's getting a lot of pressure from our women here in the House.
That's great.
But he managed to find the one woman who would agree with him to draft the Republican version of the bill.
With tribal jurisdiction.
Without.
So, what do you think?
It's going to be difficult.
But he thinks we can do it?
It's a congressman, not a prophet.
Someone needs to get...
Or a Red Bull.
Oh my gosh. Did you see this?
See what?
Leahy and Murkowski sent Boehner a letter.
Today?
3 hours ago, according to the Evening Wire.
What's this?
A letter from Senators Murkowski and Leahy.
About VAWA?
I believe so, yes, sir.
What does it say?
We should not let politics choose which victims of abuse to help and which to
very close.
Coming from the woman who carved out our sisters in Alaska.
This fundamental principle is not reflected in the House version of all reauthorization legislation.
Fascinating.
It is a strong message.
They both signed.
You think it'll convince Mayor to put it to a vote?
Would you like me to draft a response?
Sure.
What should it say?
I appreciate the hearing their thoughts, but I don't need advice from the Senate on how to run the House.
What does the letter say about last night?
Well, if it isn't the gentleman from Oklahoma.
I hope I'm not intruding.
No. My 3 o'clock is canceled.
I won't be home.
VAWA is making me a popular man. I've got Joe Biden beating down my door, and everyone in the House wants to tell me what she thinks.
They're in favor.
Not all of them.
You know where I stand.
I do. Believe me, we'll get VAWA passed. It's not the Senate version.
You know I respect you.
I do. I wish I could help you. But I've got two committee chairmen blocking the Senate bill, and they won't budge.
Hastings? Yeah, well.
I'll tell you this. If you convince Hastings to vote for tribal jurisdictions, I'll send it to the floor.
Well, you and I both know that will never happen.
Feel free to come back to me if it does.
Well, Cantor's bill removes jurisdiction.
You know it would.
It's federal delegation.
You know that won't work.
But it will pass.
What if you drafted the bill?
Me?
You're a popular guy. People take you seriously.
Not on any issue.
I disagree.
If I draft the bill, it'll be dead in the water. Folks will just say that's another one of Tom Cole's Indian bills.
We don't have a lot of options here. It's not like I can ask a Democrat to draft this.
Ask Issa.
Daryl Issa?
Well, he's Lebanese, not Chickasaw. That's like a whole different tribe.
Seriously.
He's a strong supporter of the tribes, and he's a chair of the Oversight Committee.
That committee has nothing to do with this.
Exactly. The committee exists purely to torture Obama. He's overseeing all the investigations that look into Obama, including Benghazi, so we've got ourselves a bona fide, respected Republican partisan. If Daryl Issa's name is first on the bill, folks will look at him.
Okay. Fine. Could you just check with them, see if they're willing to do it?
I already did. He said yes.
lose my next election.
Deborah.
Man.
I brought you soup.
Oh.
Great minds think alike.
You okay?
Stop throwing up.
You need to sleep.
So do you.
I got 3 hours last night.
It's not enough.
How much did you get?
Okay, we all need sleep.
Was there time for that?
We're at a tipping point. Pelosi's behind us. We got Gwen Moore and Tom Cole out there inspiring votes. Patrick McHenry and Jeff Denham stepped up. We just need to convince just a few more.
We don't.
Well.
We might not.
It's always been a possibility.
Can't believe we made it this far.
I'd give everything up. Already have. We all have. We gave up Christmas. Time to go home. You didn't want to celebrate my birthday this year. That was October. I was like, no, can't. We give up friendship. None of my friends want to talk to me anymore because I don't have time to return their phone calls. Then we give up time with our children. Dinner. Never had dinner with my children in 3 months. I can't remember the last time I was there to tell them to bed. I gave up music. You know, driving the car, I can't listen to music because I have to pray. To pray to the creator that we will solve this. For our children. If we don't get this, I can't help it. I can't face my children. How will I tell them that I failed? That they are safe in their homes or on their reservations? That anyone can come into their home and harm them, and there's nothing that their home or their tribe can do to protect them? I can't have that conversation.
There was a time when we didn't have this kind of violence.
Not like we do now.
Our men knew to view women in a sacred manner.
Not to say that we lived in a perfect society.
Because we didn't.
But we certainly didn't live in a society where women are treated like this.
It was never like this.
They introduced it.
When the soldiers came and around dressed up.
To send us on the Trail of Tears.
When they first put us on the reservations.
When they made Alaska a state.
We had to go to the fort.
To get our food.
To get our rations.
You know,
our commodities. From the soldiers.
And when we went to the fort to get our food.
What's this?
I've come for my rations.
We're all out.
Please, sir, I have children.
I'm sure you do, but we are all out.
I have to feed my children, please.
Come in the back. You don't get something for nothing around here. Come to the back with me. You do want to feed your children, right?
My grandmother.
My grandmother.
Our grandmothers. They were raped.
By the government agent.
For food. To feed their children.
Raped by the soldiers.
Just because they could.
They had to run. They had to hide. They had no choice.
Our grandmother.
My grandmother.
She's a survivor. Survivors of war.
They weren't targeted because of the color of their skin.
We aren't targeted because of the color of our skin.
We're targeted because of who we are as Indian women.
As Native American women.
Alaska Native women. Because we're citizens of sovereign nations.
Because we're sovereign women.
It's been this way for 500 years.
Since 1492.
Since 1959.
Since 1978.
We're still sovereign.
I wish I could say the war has ended.
But we can live on the continent day by day.
It's time for change.
Drafting a new response. What good will that do? If we can pass it before.
momentum. You can't stop now.
Very lazy think they can have a vote by the end of January.
Well, that's facts.
Yeah, folks.
And we don't. You tell them to slow down.
We need momentum.
90 miles per hour down a dead-end road gets you nowhere.
We just had to convince Cantor to put it to a vote.
And he's convinced it's unconstitutional.
What's unconstitutional about recognizing the tribes of jurisdiction?
Oliphant.
Are you kidding me? Have you read Oliphant?
100 times. It still doesn't make sense to me. But how do you explain the court's decision that after hundreds of years of sovereign existence, a sovereign existence that predates the United States Constitution, that all of a sudden, in 1978, tribal governments lost their sovereignty? It's gone. Why? Well, I don't know where it went. I guess it just disappeared. All I know is that when I was a kid, we had jurisdiction.
I used to watch my dad preside over tribal court.
My great-grandfather was the clerk of our Chickasaw Supreme Court.
We prosecuted everyone. Indian, non-Indian, black, white, French, Chinese. Didn't matter.
If you committed a crime on the reservation, the tribe could prosecute you.
I was 9 when the Supreme Court decided all. I remember my dad and our tribal sheriff time, Jim Standing Bear. They went through about 6 pots of coffee that night and our kitchen table just talking about it. They were upset. Concerned, you know, about what would happen to our people. And I was just a kid, but I could see it on their faces. Rachel, my sister, she was 6. I remember she was crying. We were scared. We'd never seen our dad so upset. We really weren't sure why. We knew something was wrong. When I was 18, I went off to school. When I graduated, I came home to work for the tribal police. Dad was so proud. I was serving our tribe. For me, it was the hardest thing I ever did. I remember when I got the call. May 4th, 1991. Storm that night. Kind of Oklahoma storm when the thunder shakes the walls and the air is still and you watch the lightning dance and lean different directions across the sky just waiting for the power to go out. Job of police.
Dennis, it's Sarah.
Oh, hey.
Look, these men, they just showed up. I think they were at the casino. I don't know. They were 3 of them, and they were drunk, and they attacked
me. Are you okay?
I ran away.
Where's Rachel?
In my back seat.
Is she okay?
They grabbed her, and I tried to stop them, but they tried to grab me, too, and I managed to run away to get my phone, but by the time I got back, then
what happened to Rachel?
What? I got that license plate number.
What happened to Rachel?
They raped her.
Spent all night in the hospital. Next morning, I remember talking to my dad. So you're just going to accept this?
What do you want me to do?
Prosecute them?
You're a
judge. You can issue an order.
I can't.
I have their license plates. We know their names. We know where they work. We know where they live.
They're white.
So?
We don't have jurisdiction.
That's bullshit, and you know it. Oliphant, read it. Look, Dad.
I said read it!
We granted
certiorari.
I don't even know how to pronounce that.
Read the full sentence.
We granted certiorari to decide whether Indian tribal courts have criminal jurisdiction over non-Indians. We decide that they do not. What do you think that means? Then I had to go to law school.
Did you read the entire opinion?
Yeah, that made me.
Read the last sentence.
Finally, we are not unaware of the prevalence of non-Indian crime on today's reservations, which the tribes forcefully argue requires the ability to try non-Indians. But these are considerations for Congress to weigh in deciding whether Indian tribes should be authorized to try non-Indians.
What do you think that means?
Congress has the constitutional power to recognize the inherent sovereignty in Indian tribes.
You go back, and you tell Patty Murray that if she and Leahy can get through the Senate, I will do whatever the hell it takes to pass the House.
Leahy's reintroducing the bill on Monday.
Right, please, we'll have it passed at February 1st.
We need to get our women up here.
What do you mean?
We can do politics.
I'm a lobbyist. You hired me to lobby.
We need to go where we're most powerful.
We're survivors.
It's pretty damn hard to tell a survivor she doesn't deserve justice.
Cameron did. He refused, told me he'd never put it.
But not to your face.
This movement was started by survivors. The only way to win it is to empower them.
You're right.
They have to speak for themselves.
Our stories all are powerful.
You think they'd agree?
To come here?
Lisa Brunner would.
Yes.
She stood up and spoke out in 2003 when tribal leadership wanted to ignore the whole situation.
I remember.
And NCI listened. That's why they created the task force.
What about Sharon Giles?
Yes.
Melissa Merrick?
Yes, Diane Millich.
Her story is very powerful.
They all are.
How do we get them here?
Let me see what I can do. Dangers of our environment, and they know it.
know that we're walking bullseyes. We're not targets. We're walking bullseyes. And so she went out in the middle of the night to go find my niece. She didn't want my niece to get in trouble for sneaking out, because she would have. And as my daughter walked down the road, four white guys in a black SUV with leather interior were trying to get her into the vehicle, and she said no. She kept walking. And this is the only biggest town that we have on reservation population, maybe 1,000. And as she's walking but getting more persistent, she takes off running. And they chased her down. They jumped out of the vehicle and they drug her to it. So one was driving, two held her down, and the fourth one raped her. But they had bad names on. Over their faces, but she's seen their white skin, blue eyes, and blonde hair. And when they were done, they threw her out by the bridge. And as you all, that's her mom that this boy that took the wind out of me. Slamming to the earth with such ungodly speed. Knowing that my baby was hurt. All of the measures that I had to try to protect her didn't work. My daughter isn't an animal that is hunted. She's a human being.
I want to talk to you about VAWA.
We're thankful for our funding.
I want to talk to you about the legislation. The Senate's going to go to a vote at the end of the month.
We'll be praying for you.
I want you to come to D.C.
Why me?
Because people need to hear your story.
They took Alaska out.
We're going to try to get it back in.
And I both know Murkowski won't.
That's why Congress needs to hear from you.
You know, before they made Alaska a state around 1955 or 56, the Bureau of Land Management sent surveyors out to many of the native villages in Alaska, you know, to divide up and parcel off sections of land. And then, while our families were out fishing that summer, they auctioned off our homes. When families got home to prepare for winter, they found strangers living in their houses. The federal government told us we could buy back our homes. We didn't have any money. I read about your people. Before I met you, I'd never known anyone who was Cherokee. But I read about your trail of tears. I read about how your tribe won a case in the Supreme Court in 1831. Said you had legal right to stay on your own lands, the lands that your ancestors lived on for thousands of years. And I read about how President Jackson ignored that Supreme Court ruling and forced thousands of your people to leave their homes and move to strange new land. And I read how many became sick and died in that trip. Terry, everyone keeps saying that you're different. Sorry, Lynn. Can't include the tribes in Alaska in this bill.
I'd grown up on the reservation around all my family. And when I was 18, when I went off to college, there were hardly any Indians, so it was a big transition. And I remember sitting there in my dorm room, and I just asked myself this question, what am I doing here? You know? Why did I leave my home in Cherokee to come here? And I'll never forget, I was sitting against the wall of my back up against it on the floor, just crying. And what came to me was a trail of tears. See, when the government moved my people to Indian territory, our people were the ones who stayed. It was our home. We refused to leave. Even when the government came and rounded us all up and started killing us, we didn't leave. That's where I come from. That's where I was born. That's where I was raised. And so I sat there and I realized that that vision came to me. And it was saying, Terry, as long as you live, you are never going to let this happen to Indian people again. And then I come up here to Alaska. And I realized I failed.
You haven't failed.
No. This is what makes this so devastating. Alaska is not different.
I'll come to these things every day. I'll go wherever you tell me to. It will help my
agents were all at the scene of the crime just to determine emotional issues were so complicating that after the shooting, all those services had their own measuring tapes and their own maps just to determine which one of them had jurisdiction. At the point of where the gun was fired, from where the bullet landed, to where my coworker shot and lay.
I got 5.
I got 4.
This is clearly federal.
You're at least 6 inches away from federal jurisdiction.
The bullet landed on federal land.
The gun was fired from the state.
It took hours just to decide who had jurisdiction.
This belongs with the state.
5. Take it. This is small potatoes for the feds anyway. Oh! There she is! She was hiding behind some trees.
The district attorney and the federal government all agreed that the 6th Judicial District of Colorado would prosecute, which nobody ever asked me. They would prosecute this case. Because he was never arrested or charged for any domestic violence crimes against me on tribal land, the district treated him as a first-time offender. They offered him a plea agreement. Because he had left the scene of the crime, he had a police chase with 6 officers. He crossed 2 state lines. It also put the law officers in harm's way. The district attorney offered him a plea of aggravated driving under revocation, which meant that he didn't have a driver's license while he did his crime. He took it immediately. In the end, none of the domestic violence or the shooting incident he was ever charged. It was like the attempt to shoot me and the shooting of my coworker did not happen, nor was ever discussed again. My tribe wanted to help me, and they would have charged domestic violence crimes, but they could not because of the law. In the end, he was right. The law couldn't touch him, and he was above the law. Thank you.
Thank you for sharing.
We passed the Senate.
I knew we would.
We got 78.
That's 10 more than last year.
10 Republicans switched over.
That's amazing.
On to the House.
Lord help
us. Oh, I need some caffeine.
Right, not coffee.
Right.
Terry doesn't need any caffeine.
Peppers.
This is a great call.
You don't drink coffee?
No, it does really bad for you.
I also brought bagels.
We didn't eat bagels either. The only thing eat that hippie granola stuff.
They're called Cliff Bars, and they're really good for you. Corn syrup processed.
Yeah, you went to Boston, Northern California.
Okay. We need to figure out the schedule for the week.
I spoke to Jack.
She said.
Restoration Magazine will be ready next week.
Great.
And what is sitting in the meeting with the Black Caucus?
Oh, thank God for one more.
And you said you'd meet with Pelosi?
I did.
Yes, we discussed this.
Oh, okay.
I'll be stopping Captain Horace Rogers.
What about Betty McCollum?
On my list.
I got McHenry Denham.
That's me.
Don't forget, you got Poe.
I think he's got me.
Well, whatever, you Oklahoma boys share is special, I'm sure.
Okay, we all know what we're doing.
Sharing a story.
My story.
I'm sharing my story. That's why I came to D.C. And I'm not leaving
until I've been hurt.
I'm not leaving.
Tell us all, Cassie.
Remember what Crazy Horse said at the time he prepared for battle. Strong hearts to the front!
Can you handle the press?
I'm at the Washington Post.
The congressman can't see you now.
Do you have a minute? Sure.
But I'll take your comments too.
This is about tribal sovereignty.
I'd like to ask you a couple questions.
Why are you here?
To speak up. To share my story. To stop the silence. Our women. Our children.
They're not safe.
What happened?
My coworker pushed me out of harm's way.
My husband. He threatened to drown me.
He shot my coworker in the shoulder.
Wow, that's quite the story.
See what I can do.
Natives are only 17% of Alaska's population.
39% of Native women will become victims of domestic violence.
But we make up about 50% of all victims of domestic violence.
88% of violent crimes committed against Native women are committed by a non-Native.
Because they took our land.
And they made Alaska a state.
In the Dawes Act, they took our homes.
And gave them to settlers.
Most of my neighbors are white.
Because my husband was white.
He was never prosecuted.
Anything else?
They come onto our reservation.
Just to abuse our women with impunity.
Did you call the police?
Doesn't help.
They can't do anything.
They don't have jurisdiction.
Because you're on the reservation.
According to the Supreme Court.
Because I am a Native woman living on my ancestors' land.
The law won't protect me.
What kind of message does that send to our women?
I know what message it sent to me.
We have your vote.
I don't understand.
If the violence is so bad...
If you aren't safe on your reservation...
She lives in your home.
And your home is dangerous...
Why would she leave?
Wouldn't the laws of the state protect you if you left the reservation?
No, I can't leave.
This is my home.
My great-great-great-grandfather was Wayagadoka, or Standing Wolf. During the time of the removal, when the Cherokee were forced to walk the Trail of Tears, he was living in the area that's now known as Murphy, North Carolina. When the soldiers came to take Standing Wolf and his family, a white man named George Hayes came with them. Hayes had lived among the Cherokee people for some time, and he had learned to speak Cherokee, and the people were at ease with him. So when the soldiers came, Standing Wolf went peacefully, but he asked to come back at a later time to get his wife and children, which he did. He was known as a man of his word. He asked Hayes what he could do to avoid going west and be allowed to remain in his homeland. Hayes advised him to save up his rations, and when he saw the opportunity, break away and make his way back. But to be caught escaping meant severe punishment and even death. Several weeks later, Hayes was working in his yard when he saw a small group of people approaching on the horizon. It was Standing Wolf, his wife, and several other Cherokees. Standing Wolf's wife held a small newborn baby. Hayes asked how on earth Standing Wolf had gotten away. Standing Wolf replied that he'd simply done as Hayes advised. When Standing Wolf was informed that all of his belongings and property had been auctioned off, he said, "Those things don't matter. All that mattered was that he was back in the mountains. This was home." Hayes asked about the newborn baby. Standing Wolf told him that his new son was named Waya Ojunda, or Comeback Wolf, because that was the only wish in their hearts, just to come back home. This is why I and my grandmothers and grandfathers before me came to be in the mountains. The Cherokee elders say that we have always been here. We will always be here. It's believed that we were given our home in the mountains by the Creator. Since it was He who gave it to us, only He can take it from us. So did I ever think of leaving?
Not once.
Never.
I am still here.
We will never leave. This is our home.
What about Alaska?
Alaska is home to 40% of all tribes.
What's the senator's position?
It's a unique situation.
That's 229 federally recognized tribes.
There are no tribes left in Alaska.
We have lived here for thousands of years.
Legally, according to the Supreme Court, there's no Indian country in Alaska.
Is that why the senator took Alaska out?
Alaska is different. I just wanted to say, I read Isaac.
I know it diverges from the party line, but tribal jurisdiction is important, and for me...
You have my vote.
Riff!
I read their story, Tom. I read that article in the New York Times.
Diane's story.
I read that story, and I thought, what if it was my mom? Or my sister? What if it was my daughter? Add me to your account.
My vote's yes.
Kathy, didn't expect to see you today.
I'm on my way to E&C.
Well, thanks for stopping by.
Believe me, I'd rather be here
visiting with you than sitting on some committee.
Well, what can I do for you?
I just wanted to say I met with some of the women, and I heard their stories.
They're very powerful.
You got my vote.
Thank you.
How do we get this passed?
Well, it's up to Kent.
I know, but how do we get him to move?
Well, I've tried.
He's stubborn as hell.
I'm sure it'd help if he heard from you. Directly.
Let me see what I can do.
Look, I know what you're here to discuss.
Well, then let's discuss it.
I'm not putting it to a vote.
Did you read the New York Times article?
Are you kidding me? I stand.
Look, I hate the press as much as you do.
You are the one quoting it.
This is about perception. 53% of voters in the last election were women. Exit polls show that Obama held a 10-point gender gap over Romney.
I've heard the numbers, Kathy.
Eric, if you refuse to put VAWA to a vote now, like you did last year, there will be consequences. For all of us.
We're so close.
I can feel it, but...
You think we have the votes?
Well, the votes are there.
We got a lot of press.
It's more than just buzz. Lisa Brunner was up here walking the halls, collecting votes, and Diane's story in the time.
I like your quote.
Well, thanks, but... Serious. The media coverage has things blowing up around here. I've got members coming up to me and saying they'll vote for the Senate bill.
That's great. Let's put it to a vote. See where it comes out. What's wrong?
Cantor isn't going to let this one go to a vote.
Can you talk to him?
I've tried.
We didn't come this far to give up.
I don't know what I can say to convince him.
My great-grandfather was a treaty signer. He represented our tribe and came to D.C. to sign our very last treaty. The last treaty before we were removed to Indian territory. When he came here as a leader of a sovereign nation. At a time when the United States was taking everything from us. The lands we lived on, the buffalo we lived with, the only thing we managed to preserve was our sovereignty. That treaty my grandfather signed recognized that. Like my grandfather, I'm here because I'm a representative of a sovereign nation. I know you are too. I can't find the words you need to say to convince your party leadership to put this to a vote. And I know when the time comes, you will.
Tom!
Thank you for stopping by.
I'm here because I don't want to have this conversation over here.
We need a vote.
You know the party's position on tribal jurisdiction.
I do, and I'm asking you to put Isaac Cole to a vote.
You think we can just pull the camel's nose under the tent?
No one's nose is going under any tents.
Well, they got your nose, that's for sure.
What's that supposed to mean?
You are supposed to be our guy working with them.
I think there's been a misunderstanding. I'm their guy working with you. Now, my great-great-grandfather was one of the last to travel the Chickasaw Trail of Tears. He was only 14. He walked 80 miles from 1837 to 1851. The federal government moved everywhere. We lost everything except our sovereignty. After we got to our new home in Indian Territory, my great-great-grandfather served as the clerk of the Chickasaw Supreme Court. And after him, my great-grandfather served as the clerk of our Supreme Court. And then he served as the last Chickasaw treasurer before Oklahoma became a state. Now, I come from a long line of Chickasaw leaders, men and women who have served not only their sovereign tribal government, as I now serve mine, but also the state of Oklahoma and the United States. My mother was the first Native American woman ever elected to the state senate in Oklahoma. And now here I am, in the United States House of Representatives. I have a lot of respect for this government, this sovereign government, and how it works. And it works because people vote. They vote in the presidential election and in their state elections, and here in the House, we vote. When a bill passes, it passes. When it doesn't get enough votes, it fails. But no one has to guess whether their majority of the citizens' representatives were for or against a bill when there's a vote. That's all we're asking for. That's all we want. Please, let us have the vote.
They're voting!
I remember where I was.
I remember what I was doing.
I remember what I was thinking.
That I'll never forget.
I was on the floor of the house.
I had my home in Fairfax.
On my reservation.
In Cherokee.
In Alaska.
Watching CNN.
C-SPAN.
Facebook.
Watching the vote.
Working for votes.
I couldn't breathe.
I was so nervous.
All I could do was pray.
What's the vote?
30.
We got 30?
We need 218.
We need your vote.
You got my vote.
31.
Thank you.
62.
My whole life.
I've dreamed of this.
85.
I'm ready for this.
114.
You got my vote.
Thank you!
115!
Everything depends on this.
What if we lose?
We can't lose.
Not an option.
201!
201?
Oh my God.
I just prayed
to the Creator.
215!
Holy smoke.
216!
Got this!
217!
Is this for real?
218!
219!
Oh, they're still coming!
More votes!
235!
246!
250!
285!
286!
286!
286! 286 votes!
I couldn't believe it!
I could hardly see you. I was texting. I was crying so hard.
I had to scream.
I scared my neighbors.
It went to the victory dance.
I prayed for my sisters.
It just seemed unreal.
It felt like a dream.
It was amazing.
It was humbling.
It was a miracle.
What about Alaska?
Next time. I promise.
Why were we left out?
Miss Millich?
This is Diane.
Hi, I'm calling on behalf of President Obama and Vice President Biden need you here at the signing ceremony.
Right. Am I getting bumped?
No.
When's the signing ceremony?
We need you here by tomorrow.
Oh. I have to ask my doctor.
Vice President Biden would like for you to introduce him.
To who?
To everyone at the signing ceremony. Everyone in the White House agrees that your story in the New York Times was incredibly powerful and inspirational to all who worked on making this bill become law. The President and Vice President would like to invite you to share your story with the nation.
Well, what do I wear?
Hello and welcome. Thank you for joining us today for this very important event, the signing of the Reauthorization of the Violence Against Women Act. Woo!
It doesn't protect me.
Shedra, can it true?
Yupiwa Imangamuk. I am Yupik Eskimo from the native village of Imangamuk.
We were here before.
Before you brought your schools.
Before you brought your government.
Before you brought your violence.
Before you forced us to speak English. Before you took our jurisdiction.
Our ancestors have lived here for thousands of years, and
we will never leave.
VAWA 2013. It's a start.
We have more work to do.
Until this government recognizes our tribe's sovereign authority to protect all of our Native women,
none of us are safe.
Until this government recognizes the rights of our Alaska Native sisters,
none of us are safe.
VAWA is a miracle, a spiritual miracle.
Just
but,
a sliver.
But it's just the beginning.
It's just a sliver. The first sliver of a whole moon. Campaign.
VAWA 2018 if we have not repealed it by VAWA 2018. I hope every single person in this building will support a VAWA repealing 2018 and including Alaska Native women. And unless it includes Alaska Native women in VAWA 2018, we cannot accept it. Please, please, we need your support.
Exemption issues. And we need any support all over the country and you can spread it. You said our baggage needs to be reelected. It's critical to the native tribes in Alaska that Senator Begich be reelected.
Yourselves and do as you will. And thank you once again for